Good.
My name is Catherine Gibson, and it is my pleasure, on behalf of Knox-Metropolitan United Church, Council of Canadians Regina, Clean Green Regina, and Kairos Regina, to welcome everyone here. I hope that by the end of this evening, we all will find that we have learned a thing or two. I'm delighted to be able to introduce Dr. Patricia W. Elliott, Professor, School of Journalism, University of Regina, as our moderator for the formal part of this evening. Trish, as she is known to many of us, has a limitless capacity for taking on many important causes in our city. She makes a difference because she's a person who can keep her head when all around are losing theirs. So let's hope there will be no lost heads tonight. Trish, I invite you to explain the ground rules and get this forum underway.
Good evening. Can you all hear me? Good evening, candidates and voters. The format for tonight's discussion is as follows. An invitation was sent out to all registered candidates and parties in the three ridings in Regina. Each party was invited to select one candidate to speak at the head table. Other candidates are here tonight, and members of the audience are invited to connect with them on a one-on-one in the display area downstairs after the formal part of our evening closes. Each candidate at the head table will be given 2 minutes for opening remarks. The order of speaking was determined about 15 or 20 minutes ago by random draw. Candidates will then be invited to answer 4 questions that were prepared by the coalition. They've received copies of these questions in advance, which I now also have, and I will read them aloud. Each will have a maximum of 1 minute to respond to each question, and the order of response has been determined also randomly in advance. Members of the audience are invited to write additional questions on the papers that are provided, and these questions are going to be grouped into themes by the volunteers here at this table and presented in the form of 1 question per theme. So you may not hear the exact wording of your question, but hopefully it will be encapsulated in the questions that they come up with. Candidates will have 1 minute to respond, or they may pass if they have no response to a particular question. And that order, again, is random. At about 8:15, candidates will be invited to make closing remarks of 3 minutes each in the reverse order of the opening remarks. Throughout the evening, remarks and responses will be closely timed and enforced. You will receive a 15-second warning to finish during the allotted time. The point of this evening is not to debate or to critique one another. It is meant as an information session so that candidates can speak directly to you about their positions on topics that are of concern to voters. With this in mind, I'd like to introduce the candidates now at our head table. In the number one position from the random draw, we have Tamala Friesen, running for the Green Party in Regina, New Hampshire. Next, we have Wojciech Dalata, running for the Libertarian Party, also in Regina, New Hampshire. Next is Aaron Weir, the New Democratic Party candidate in Regina, New Hampshire. And next, Louis Brown, Liberal Party candidate in Regina, New Hampshire. Thank you all. So without further ado, I'm going to call on Tamala Friesen to get us started with her opening remarks. And you have the option of coming to the podium or the table. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you for organizing and for hosting, and thank you for coming out. to challenge us all to higher levels, and thank you, my candidate colleagues, for joining us and making this a group conversation. I have some friends up in Saskatoon in their senior years. They live in a beautiful house with running water and internet, and it was all paid for, and it was their retirement nest egg, and they put it on the market looking to transition into a house that was easier to live in for seniors. And the first person wanted to buy it and put a great offer in and had the contractor come and take a look, and the foundations were shot. Everything looked fine, but the foundations were gone. The nest egg was gone. Everything looked fine, but the foundations were shot. This is where we are at with Canadian democracy. Our internet still works, our bus systems still work, yet life is pretty good and pretty fine, but our democratic foundations are shot. First past the post, 38% of the vote, gets 54% of the seats, gets 100% of the power. That is not democracy. We need to replace that with proportional representation, first off. We have a prime minister's office that is unelected, unaccountable. We have a prime minister's office that is unelected, unaccountable, unconstitutional, and unnecessary. We need divest power from the prime minister's office immediately. We do not live in a friendly dictatorship. We live in a democracy. We want it back. We need to divest power from party leaders and return it to MPs so we can do our jobs, which is to represent our interests to Ottawa. And that's why I chose the Green Party, because I can vote for my constituents all the time.
Thank you, and then we'll now call on Vice Chair Dewada.
Thank you. I'm running this election for a number of reasons. First of all, I'm running to represent Regina Louven constituency and to represent their interests, first and foremost, my loyalties to the constituents, not to political parties. If my party did not have candidate autonomy, I would probably not run for them. The second, I run because I see that the country is going in the wrong direction, at least in my opinion. It is concerning that we accumulate more and more national debt. Presently, we pay 11% of our tax dollars just to service the debt, just to pay the interest on this with low rates. If the rates go high, you'll be paying 30%. We will not be able to afford at that point any programs that we are talking about. We will be talking about austerity or the Greece scenario if we continue on this path. The other thing is what concerns me when I 20 years ago, Canada was known to be a peacekeeping country. Now we are a country that actually we send our airplanes to bomb bomb villages or so-called enemies in other countries. We are actually favoring military interventionism. We should not be participating in civil wars of other countries. Let them solve the regional problem themselves. Our troops should be staying home and we talk a lot in the media. We hear a lot about, first of all, global warming. Now we're talking about global warming and global climate change. Well, this kind of pushed the environmental agenda aside. We should be talking about having clean water, air, and solid, so we can eat healthy and breathe healthy. And the last thing. Well, we probably don't want too much of wealth redistribution, but if we see a poor people on the street, we will give a few dollars. We should redistribute at least a little bit for the most poor people. Thank you.
All right, I was promised I wouldn't have to wrestle with the microphone, so I really appreciate that. I'm Aaron Weir, your federal NDP candidate for Regina Louven. In real life, I'm an economist with the United Steelworkers, and I'm really pleased to see a couple of steelworkers in the crowd this evening. But I started my career as an economist with the Federal Treasury Board Secretariat, the Department of Finance, and the Privy Council Office. I've also worked with the last three NDP premiers of Saskatchewan and ran for the provincial NDP leadership in 2012. My background in economics, in politics, and in government would help me to represent our community in Parliament. One local issue that motivated me to run in this election was the recent referendum on Regina's new wastewater treatment plant. I was active in a campaign to keep this facility public, but the Conservative government refused to provide funding unless it was privatized. We need an MP who will speak up for federal infrastructure funding without those strings attached. Now, since this is a citywide forum, I also want to introduce the other two NDP candidates in Regina. We have in the front row April Bourgeois for Regina Wascana. Of Prairie Dog Magazine, which I know you all enjoy reading. She also leads a community-based organization that helps disabled people in Regina. So an excellent candidate to look at in Regina Wascana. Our candidate in Regina Qu'Appelle is Niall Kuyak. He had some other commitments this evening, so he's not in the room. But I do have some of his literature downstairs, so if you live in the northeast part of Regina, check that out. So that's your NDP team. Thanks very much for the opportunity tonight.
And now Louis Brown, please.
Thank you very much, Madam Moderator. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Salut aussi à tous nos amis francophones, Tansé, and welcome to Treaty 4 territory. It is an honor to be here with you representing the Liberal Party of Canada as the candidate in Regina-Louvain. I'm also delighted to have with me our candidate in Regina-Qu'Appelle, Della Anaquad, and I can say that as an individual with the someone with 2 degrees, one of them being a professional degree, Della actually puts me to shame, she has 5 degrees. In addition to that, our candidate from Regina Wascana, former Finance Minister Ralph Goodale. Now, when we discuss our party platforms, what it boils down to, and you might have heard the expression, the proof is in the pudding. Well, in this case, it's not in the pudding, it's in the costing. The proof is in the costing. And in a September 26th, 2015 Huffington Post article, former Parliamentary Budget Officer Kevin Page called the Liberal plan realistic during an interview on CBC News. What he also said is that we, the Liberals, have updated the numbers from budget 2015, so it takes into account a weaker economy in 2015, weaker oil prices. The plan is based on the latest available figures from the Parliamentary Budget Officer and the Bank of Canada. As one of your former city councillors who served from 2006 to 2012, I want to finish in Ottawa for you what we started in Regina at City Hall. I lived and breathed infrastructure challenges for 6 years, and I can tell you for 100% fact, city halls all across this country, including in Regina, cannot fix our infrastructure challenges alone. We need a partner in Ottawa, we need a prime minister and a team who understands the infrastructure challenges, crumbling sidewalks, crumbling roads, and these sorts of things. In addition, we are going to stand up for middle-class families in Regina-Louvain and all across Saskatchewan. Standing up for the middle class has been a key point for us and a priority that you can count on the Liberals to stand up for. Thank you.
Pre-prepared questions that the candidates did receive in advance, and I'll be calling them for this round. The order is 3-4-1-2, so we'll be starting with Aaron Lear. I will read the question. They have copies of the questions in front of them, although if you don't have your copy and need it repeated, just let me know and I can repeat it. And they'll be answering from the table, passing the mic down, and then returning to the podium for their closing remarks. So, if we are ready, I will begin with the opening question. It is on the subject of criminal justice, prison, and healing. Canada's crime rate has been decreasing for years, yet changes to criminal justice policy in the past decade have resulted in more people going to prison for longer periods of time. Many inmates in Canada are serving sentences for a non-violent offense. 76% of prisoners in provincial jails and 33% of those in federal penitentiaries. Many repeat offenders are mentally ill, cognitively challenged, and/or addicted. The questions for candidates are, how then do you and your party propose to make effective use of the resources committed to justice and corrections? How would you and your party develop restorative approaches to justice that support healing for victims, offenders, and communities? How would you prepare and support women and men who are serving sentences to be good neighbors in our communities upon their release? And you have 1 minute.
All of that in 1 minute. So we have a conservative government right now that, in the face of all the evidence and all the experts, has pursued what they call a tough-on-crime policy, which has put, you know, more people in jail, you know, despite the fact that the crime rate's falling. You know, they're putting people in jail for things like, you know, using marijuana, which, as far as I'm concerned, shouldn't even be a criminal offense. You know, so this is... you know, so this is a very poor direction from the conservatives. The criminal justice system is supposed to do sort of three things: punish people who've committed crimes, deter people from committing crimes, and rehabilitate people who've committed crimes. The conservatives seem to have put all the emphasis on punishment and forgotten about rehabilitation. That's what we need to rediscover. We also need better social policies to address the causes of crime so that people aren't in contact with the criminal justice system in the first place. Thanks very much.
The next answerer is candidate number 4, which is Louis Brown.
Thanks very much. The Conservatives' done on crime agenda is focused on punitive measures and ideological posturing rather than measures to keep Canadians safe. Further, they have wasted billions of Canadian taxpayers' dollars fighting court cases their own lawyers advised them were doomed to fail relating to mandatory minimum sentences. A Liberal government will focus on protecting Canadians and making our communities safer by pursuing evidence-based policies that reduce crime and prevent reoffending. While some criminals no doubt need to be locked up for long periods of time, that should be a last resort, as it is far more expensive to do so. Rehabilitative programs that are proven to limit repeat offenses should be maximized. The Liberal Party of Canada believes that corrections must include an emphasis on rehabilitation and that prison farms taught practical skills and helped prisoners prepare for reintegration into Canadian society. Proper rehabilitation is needed to promote public safety and reduce repeat offending. The prison farm delivered on both counts and should be reopened. Thank you.
Next is number 1, Tamala Friesen.
Thank you. A few years ago, I was facilitating a job-finding club at a regional college in Saskatchewan, and this Aboriginal Student Association put on a professional development for the First Nations students, and it's titled, How to Navigate the Justice System as a First Nations Person. If we want to fix justice, we've got to fix racism. And to do that, we need to get to know our neighbors. Once we get to know our neighbors, we can develop empathy and we can develop actions. Some of the green actions is to fully implement the recommendations of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, to reopen the farms that were shut down and the prison programs to help rehabilitate, to also implement a guaranteed annual income to address poverty, and to stop minimum sentences. How's that?
The putting good people in prison often doesn't serve a purpose. However, if somebody commits heinous crimes like murdering another person or raping, these persons do deserve being punished for their crimes. On the other hand, people who commit crimes, so-called victimless crimes, simply for taking, let's say, a drink or having marijuana, smoke, or other victimless crimes, their place is not in prison. They should be educated, perhaps, and left alone even. Now, so these people have no place in prison. It's so-called white-collar crimes, like somebody cheats somebody out of money. Well, these folks should restore the money to the people that they victimized. As for the people who are with psychiatric illness or addicted, well, they need psychiatric care and help. We need more psychiatrists and maybe not so much prison guards.
We'll now proceed to the next questions. The order for these questions is 2, 4, 3, 1. These questions deal with Canadian mining companies operating abroad. Canada is home to more than half of the world's mining companies. Human rights abuses, including displacement of communities and violation of labor rights, and environmental abuses are increasingly associated with their projects. To the candidates, would you and your party support the creation of an independent extractive sector ombudsman to investigate complaints of human rights and environmental abuses by Canadian companies operating internationally and to make recommendations to companies and to the government? Would you support legislative access to Canadian courts for people who have been seriously harmed by the international operations of Canadian companies? So starting with candidate number 2, you have 1 minute.
So we're talking about mining operations and businesses running abroad, not in Canada, but Canadian companies. Well, Germany, for example, has a law that you cannot bribe people outside of their country. It is punishable there. The other countries, businesses complain that it puts them in competitive disadvantage. As for the environment, we actually outsourced a lot of polluting industries to poor countries, and we are not concerned too much about what happens in those countries. The other question that was about whether you would recommend access folks to Canadian courts. Canadians also can access courts in the other countries, so they can access the courts, but on the other hand, the laws in Canada should protect mostly the Canadians. And
2 seconds.
Oh, 2 seconds. Thank you very much.
The Liberal Party of Canada shares your concerns and has long been fighting for transparency, accountability, and sustainable in the mining sector. Specifically, Liberal Member of Parliament John McKay advanced Bill C-300, the Responsible Mining Act, which was narrowly defeated in August 2012. According to the Globe and Mail, MP McKay's Bill C-300 would have created a credible, objective forum to promote dispute resolution and help companies avoid and resolve conflict. Canadians like you expect our businesses to reflect our values, and the success of Canadian business rests in part on Canada's good reputation. When one company or individual's associated with a company acts in a way that damages our reputation, it hurts all international Canadian business. Continuing to address these issues and finding meaningful solutions is a priority for us in the Liberal Party of Canada. It is through dialogue with Canadians like you that the Liberal Party of Canada can shape policies that reflect the values of Canadians. Thank you. Merci beaucoup.
So I mentioned that I work for the United Steelworkers Union, which is the largest union of miners in Canada. And we've been very active in trying to expose some of the misdeeds of Canadian mining companies abroad. First of all, in a spirit of solidarity and concern for the welfare of people in other countries. But second of all, because we don't want a race to the bottom where Canadian mining companies are able to undercut health, safety, environmental, and labor standards in Canadian mines. So it's important for both those reasons. I'm very proud of the fact that our union is quite involved in the campaign for Bill C-300, which Louis mentioned. I'm proud of the fact that all the NDP MPs voted in favor of that private member's bill, which would have done exactly what this question suggests, to make Canadian mining companies legally accountable in Canada for their misdeeds abroad. Thanks very much.
The short answer is, yeah, I would be happy to advocate for those two items. A little bit longer. If we're talking about global economy, we need to recognize that we are a global community and then that we further have global responsibility. The Green Party wants to make sure that we do not engage in any more FIPAs, Free Investor Protection Acts. They undermine local sovereignty, ours, and any weaker economies. We want to make sure that any agreements that we enter into uphold the sovereignty of the local governments, our own governments, the local environment, our environment, Indigenous peoples' inherent rights, and consumer protection and labor protection. So we want to encourage a global governance system to help resolve these disputes. And once again, I'd say I'm very pleased to advocate for these 2 points.
Our next questions involve taxes and inequality. And the order is 4, 3, 2, 1. The concentration of wealth and power at the top levels of society, what the Occupy movement called the 1%, is increasing, leading to inequality by many citizens in their ability to participate in our economy and our society. Taxation review may be one tool to counter this trend, since some corporations use existing laws, tax loopholes, and foreign tax havens to avoid paying their fair share of taxes, thus actually paying at a much lower rate than the stated official corporate income tax rate. Questions for candidates. What would you and your party do to reduce tax avoidance and tax evasion and to increase recovery of unpaid corporate taxes from, for example, tax havens? Would you favor a low-rate tax on international financial transactions? And we are beginning with candidate number 4.
For 10 years, Stephen Harper has ignored those at the heart of our economy, the middle class. While doing most of the heavy lifting, middle-class Canadians have had to work longer and harder for an ever-shrinking piece of the pie and less financial security. Canadian families need to have money in their pockets to save, invest, and grow the economy. We want to build an economy that works for the middle class, because when our economy works for the middle class, our country works for everyone. A Liberal government will cut taxes for middle class Canadians. If your annual income is between $44,700 all the way up to about $215,000, and that includes millions and millions of Canadians, the Liberal Party of Canada, and only the Liberal Party of Canada, will cut your personal income taxes. We will raise taxes on the wealthiest 1% so that we can do this. Across Canada, that's an annual $3 billion economic stimulus, with the delivery mechanism being everyday Canadians. When the middle class is strong and prosperous, we create jobs, spur investment, and stimulate growth for all Canadians. Thank you very much. Merci beaucoup.
Well, I'm not sure if Louis actually said anything about dealing with tax havens there. And I mean, when the Liberals were in power, they certainly didn't do anything to combat them either. In fact, they signed this tax treaty with Barbados that really enabled a lot of tax avoidance and tax evasion. The NDP is serious about trying to tackle this problem. One recent incident from our province was Cameco actually selling uranium at a low, low price of $10 a pound to its subsidiary in Switzerland, which doesn't use any uranium and doesn't have any nuclear facilities, simply in order to resell the uranium at much higher prices to the countries that were actually using it. The whole point of this scheme was obviously to avoid paying Canadian tax, and I think it was quite shocking that none of Saskatchewan's MPs spoke up or said anything about this. So elect some new Democrats, and you'll hear more on tax havens.
What I would recommend that rather focusing on one percenters, you should make sure that everybody, whether you have 1% or 10% or 50%, should get richer if you make the economy more free. Now, the other thing about the taxes should be as simple as possible without any loopholes, so nobody has excuse hiring expensive lawyers to avoid paying taxes. Now, if you avoid so simplified taxes, well, it is a crime. Al Capone didn't end up well by not paying taxes, as we know. The other thing, so about the second point, do I favor a low rate tax on international financial transactions? I studied international trade for 1 year, and I don't think this is a good idea. In the international trade, the millions and billions of dollars moving like instantaneously in a millisecond, how you want to tax this? It is practically impossible to stifle the international trade. These transactions are too fast, it is impossible to tax them. It would be like taxing your bank account transaction. If you withdraw $5,000, you pay 5% tax on this. Thank you.
The Green Party proposes to simplify the tax structure like the Libertarians. If it's not so complex, it gets harder to make the loopholes. We definitely need to close them. We estimate we lose about $3 billion a year through loopholes, so we need to find ways to close them. So through simplification, and then also a root and branch review of the entire tax code. It's overdue. We need to take a look at it and see where things are going. We'd like to eliminate boutique tax credits and just keep it simple. The Tobin tax, the international financial transactions. Yes, the Green Party supports this. Mr. Tobin was a Nobel Prize winning economist that came up with this idea. I'm willing to listen to his opinion on what might work to discourage frivolous transactions and generate a lot of money for international development. That's where the Green Party would like to put that kind of tax money to.
The fourth and final prepared question is on environment, enshrining the right to a healthy environment in the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms. Many Canadians have signed the Blue Dot petition asking for the right to a healthy environment to be included in Canada's Charter of Rights and Freedoms. Question for the candidate, what steps does your party believe are necessary to pave the way for this inclusion? And the order is 4132.
Point of order, Madam Moderator. Are we permitted to be critical of our opponents' statements or positions, or are we supposed to simply direct to the audience how we will positively influence Canadian policy? A point of order, Madam Moderator, question for you. Are we permitted to be critical of our opponents' statements and positions, or as the instructions directed, are we simply to tell the audience how our policies will positively influence Canadian policy?
I'll leave that to the coalition.
I think the intent was to tell the party's policy.
Thank you for that. May I commence?
Yes.
Liberals would rather talk with the premiers about immediate action on the environment, not reopening the Constitution. Our plan will create jobs, grow the economy, and protect the environment. During the Harper decade, our environment has suffered. Canadians cannot afford to let this inaction continue. The cost is too high. We will undo the damage done by Stephen Harper and give to our children and grandchildren a country even more beautiful, sustainable, and prosperous than the one we have now. The Liberal plan will deliver real change for our environment by taking action on climate change, investing in clean technologies, creating clean jobs and investment, restoring credibility to environmental assessments, preserving and promoting our national parks, and protecting our wildlife and waterways. In the process, we will phase out fossil fuel subsidies, expand investment in the clean technology sector, create a green investment bond to develop more renewable energy, and suspend admission fees to our national parks for the 150th anniversary of Canadian Confederation. Thank you very much. Merci beaucoup.
Can we pause for a second?
The Green Party is, of course, supportive of this initiative, and Mr. Brown alluded to the difficulty when it involves constitutional change. Some of the things that we want to do to pave the way for constitutional change when it comes up is to modify the way we make that change, to include referenda, so that the people have a say. It's not just the province and governments at the table. The other thing we would like to do is create a council of governments, which is a good way to start getting more collaboration going on these kind of initiatives. We need to be talking to each other. We need a first minister's conference as soon as possible, but this council of governments is more than that. It is the federal government bringing to the table provincial governments, municipal governments, indigenous governments, to talk on these important issues, how we go through and not continue to bump people back and forth between levels of government. So those are two ideas where we want to try and open up a constitutional amendment to make it almost possible.
Well, I thought that having a healthy environment we should take for granted. It should be obvious that we should have it. We don't need extra laws to tell us that we should have it. Now, the point is that if somebody is running business, whatever operation is, being a chemical factory or mining, the cost of possible environmental damage should be included in the cost of operation. That means that the businesses or industry should have enough insurance or hedging to pay for the damage. It should be part of the business cycle from the beginning to the end. If the pipelines break or the train derail, this should be insurance covering this, and these businesses should upfront buy that insurance. We should not be asking the taxpayers to foot the bill for this. If they know that the taxpayers pay, they will not buy insurance. They will simply calculate this into their business plan. Okay. Again, thank you very much.
Well, I'm proud to say that I'm one of the Canadians that has signed the Blue Dot petition. I'm also proud of the fact that our federal leader, Tom Mulcair, was the Environment Minister in Quebec, and while he was in that role, he added the right to a clean environment to the Quebec Charter of Rights. So this can be done, and we have a leader to do it. But whether or not the constitutional change happens, it's important that we start taking action to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. We're proposing a cap and trade system to limit emissions and ratchet them down over time. We're also proposing investment in renewable power, energy conservation, and public transit. Our province has tremendous potential for solar, wind, and geothermal energy, and we need a federal government that's going to make the investments to take advantage of that opportunity to clean up the environment and create green jobs. Thanks very much.
We have lots of room for the audience questions. I have the first question from the voters before me. And the order of answering for this question is 1, 3, 2, 4. And the question is, what is your election platform for cities? The needs are great.
We've probably all heard that cities get 8 cents of every tax dollar. That's not enough. So the Green Party wants to devote 1 percentage point of the GST to cities to spend how they want. Again, we want to create that council of governments so that cities are brought more to the forefront. This is where most of us live. We have to improve that mechanism and give local governments far more control over where public policy hits the road, right? The other thing, I think it's gone. It's the first time you've been able to shut me up. I'm sorry, it's just in my head. We'll talk about it after.
Okay.
Well, I think it's a really appropriate question for this panel of Regina Louvain candidates, because of course this is a purely urban riding, which we actually haven't had in Saskatchewan for many years and decades now. So it's quite exciting to have an MP who can really speak up in favor of the city of Regina's interests and needs. The NDP is proposing greater federal investment in municipal infrastructure, and importantly, we're proposing that that investment come without P3 strings attached, so the city could actually invest publicly in public infrastructure. Certainly one type of infrastructure we're very interested in and that I think our city needs is a better public transit system. It's a way of creating jobs, it's a way of helping people get to work, it's a way of cleaning up the environment. So I certainly look forward to being able to speak up on behalf of our city's interests, and I think having a federal partner on infrastructure is one of the most important things that could happen.
In Saskatchewan, actually, we have two major cities, and we are kind of fortunate that Saskatchewan actually is quite booming, so it's a lot of more money is pouring into those cities, and we see that the city is actually growing and getting prettier and nicer. It is an interest not only the city, but also the province and businesses who operate that these cities are vibrant and modern and attractive to live in. When somebody comes from outside, what do we look in the city? We look as enough green places. It is the streets are well maintained. Do we have good school, good education? Is the healthcare delivered properly? This is what we look when we move to another city, and we should be taking care that whoever is trying to improve the city, we should help that. Now the cities. Municipality, so it's a different level of government. You know, in this election, we are two steps away from this. With this federal election, and it's province, and we're talking about municipalities.
Thanks very much for this question. I love Regina. It's my hometown. I'm just absolutely delighted that our party has made the largest ever commitment to invest in infrastructure in Canadian history. $60 billion over the next 10 years, divided into three components. $20 billion for public transit, transportation networks. $20 billion for social infrastructure, and that includes affordable housing, seniors care centers, child care centers, and a whole host of housing spectrum issues, as well as $20 billion for green infrastructure, waterways, and making our buildings more resilient to climate change and the extreme weather events that we can expect more often. As one of your former city councilors, it really was a challenge grappling with our infrastructure issues and trying to fix it on the backs of property taxes. I'm so honored and delighted to be a member of a party that is going to tackle it head on with the biggest investment in Canadian history. Thank you. Merci beaucoup.
We'll now move on to the next question. The order of answering is 2, 3, 4, 1. And the question is, Canada's international reputation has declined since Harper came to power. What would you suggest to restore Canada's standing in the world?
We talked about this a little bit before. First of all, we are respected in the world when we are peacekeeping force in the world to help other countries to prosper and solve their problems. Now our reputation is down because we are militaristic and we're sending our troops and aircrafts to bomb other countries. This doesn't buy us any love in those countries. And the second is that our reputation will be better if our economy is stronger. If you have strong economy and the citizens who prosper, we will get the respect from other countries. The third, we should participate in agreements with other countries to foster international cooperation. And if we are leaders in these agreements to everybody's benefit, we should be part of this. We should not be unilateral.
So I think a very important part of restoring Canada's international reputation is to really reclaim our role as peacekeepers, as honest brokers on the world stage, as people who are really concerned about humanitarian assistance. And we've got a huge crisis going on right now with Syrian refugees. And we've got a conservative government that's mishandled it. They're not doing anything to help these people that are running for their lives. And they're using security as an excuse for not having done anything. What the NDP is saying is we do need to bring in refugees. We need to start doing the security screening process now so that we can actually get some people over here and actually play a constructive role in helping to alleviate that crisis. So that would be a good way for Canada to start to rebuild our international reputation. Another thing we need to do is start taking real action on climate change. I talked about this more on the environmental question, but I think the complete lack of action on climate change is one of the main things that's kind of tarred our international image. Thanks very much.
I certainly agree with the question. Our international reputation has been degraded. I think it's largely a product of Mr. Harper's approach to the world. His ideology prevents him from being a consensus builder and working with others who don't share his worldview. The thing about Justin Trudeau, it's not his hair, it's his ears. He's an excellent listener. He grew up listening to his father, engaging in serious discussions with former Prime Minister Pierre Trudeau's colleagues. He's an excellent listener, and that will be the stark contrast between Prime Minister Justin Trudeau and Mr. Harper. We will be a bridge builder, a consensus builder. And if we look at Africa, for example, the Conservative government turned their back on Africa. When you do that, you lose over 50 votes at the UN, and that's one reason why we lost our seat on the UN Security Council in 2010. As the party that created and invented peacekeeping, yes, you can count on the Liberal Party to reinvest and reinvigorate our peacekeeping initiatives and also just to engage in multilateral initiatives. Thank you, Mr. Bahouk.
This is another one of those areas that shows our democratic foundation's problem. We need to get them fixed if we want to restore our reputation. On the doorsteps, I've actually had people crying on my shoulder about the loss of reputation, particularly when it comes to peacekeeping. We used to have thousands of missions. We now have less than 120. We've really transformed, and Canadians haven't wanted that. When I talk to my neighbors at the doorstep, we don't want that. We are a peacekeeping nation. We need to get back to it. And we can get back to it with a restored parliament where MPs can pressure the government to do what the Canadian people want and not what the corporation wants or whoever they're bowing to. The other thing on environmental leadership, obviously the Green Party thinks that we need to be leaders in the world and not the dinosaurs anymore. So we need to get back to the table, the global table, and talk about the environment.
This one is on the subject of health funding. The order will be 4, 1, 2, 3. And the question is, since 2014, health funding to the provinces has been reduced by $987 million through inequitable changes to Canadian health transfer equalization formula, with more reductions to come. Would your party sign a 10-year plan with the provinces to strengthen the healthcare system, harmonize the standards between provinces, and ensure stable funding? Do you need that one again? Would you like it again? Since 2014, health funding to the provinces has been reduced by $987 million through inequitable changes to Canadian health transfer equalization formula, with more reductions to come. Would your party sign a 10-year plan with the provinces to strengthen the health care system, harmonize the standards between provinces, and ensure stable funding? And over again is 4-1-2-3.
Thanks very much. The healthcare accord needs to be revisited. It is expiring under Mr. Harper and being degraded. We were the last government. We renegotiated that in 2004, and that needs to be significantly reinvested in. We've made some progress on wait times with respect to healthcare. We need to revisit that. As far as drugs and pharmacare, we need to leverage the buying power of the federal government working in cooperation with the provincial governments. And again, going back to our $20 billion pledge on social infrastructure, when it comes to elder care, and we're talking about a continuum of responses to that, whether it's home care or extended care, palliative care, and then end-of-life care, our $20 billion investment in social infrastructure will go a long ways towards advancing that, as well as home care. And then with respect to health care and our vision and our initiative, we also need an approach to mental health, which translates to our first responders and our veterans. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I have often been very glad that I have a health care system to wait for, even that, though that can be frustrating. I would much rather have a public system to wait for than a private system that I cannot access. The Green Party is committed to our public system, our universal system, our accessible system, and we believe that the federal government has to get back into a leadership role, a leadership position, and that starts with more funding, getting back to a 50-50 model. So that's a lot more funding on the federal government side. It'll help us to enforce the Health Act. We can attach it to funding, we can keep it public. We want to uphold and strengthen the principles, and we want to add to healthcare, add preventative medicine to healthcare, add alternative therapies to healthcare where appropriate, and add pharmacare to healthcare.
So this question deals with the method of paying for healthcare. And from my perspective, I am neutral whether you pay for healthcare one way or the other, as long as it is paid. Whether we have provincial health insurance or federal health insurance and we transfer money between these insurance plans, it really doesn't make us any healthier or happier. This is the same taxpayers who pays to federal government and provincial government, and then is giving back to the patient who is in the province. Probably the middlemen are not needed. I would rather keep the healthcare money directly in the province where the delivery of the healthcare occurs. What I have an issue is that we should allow the professionals to deliver care as they see the best possible. That means that I'm for private healthcare delivery. The doctors and hospitals and communities should organize delivery of their healthcare. How it is paid is secondary thing.
Well, I appreciate that my libertarian colleague was straightforward about supporting private healthcare delivery, because I think the party that's not here, the Conservatives, also support it. They're just not very straightforward about it. What they're doing is cutting back the increases to the Canada Health Transfer to put pressure on provincial governments to either cut back public services or to privatize and contract out elements of the public Medicare system. So to rebuild our public health care system, we need a federal government that's actually going to increase and stabilize the Canada Health Transfer. But more than that, we need a federal government that's prepared to sit down with the provinces and actually apply and, if necessary, enforce the principles of the Canada Health Act, which require a publicly administered healthcare system. So it's about more money, but it's also about having an NDP government that will use that money to ensure that we have a consistent public Medicare system across this great country.
The order of the next question will be 2314. Given that we appear to be headed toward a minority government, can you as a candidate pledge that you will work with others, with other parties on issues of common concern to make sure that Parliament continues to function and an early election will not be called?
So I do represent the Libertarian Party of Canada, but really our structure is that I'm de facto independent in a way because our candidates are independent. We don't have party whips or party discipline much. So saying this, my only loyalty is to the constituency, and we can actually contact constituency very easily nowadays with current technologies through employing the direct democracy means. Now, if as an individual, I am a member of parliament, I have no problem working with any other members of parliament. As long as their ideas are similar to mine and they don't conflict with my conscience and what the constituency wants. I am happy to work with Green Party on environmental issue. I'm happy to work with NDP on the poverty issue. I'm happy to work with Liberals with good track record of balancing budgets in the past. Well, I'm happy to work with Conservatives who may have some support for business, but some may think that it's going too far. But each member of parliament should work together for better of Canada.
Well, yes, I mean, I would certainly be keen to work with other political parties in Parliament, but more than my own personal willingness, I think it's important to emphasize that the NDP has a real track record of working with other parties in Parliament. Tom Mulcair is the leader who's been by far the clearest about his willingness to enter into coalitions with other parties to prevent Stephen Harper from continuing to govern. And I think earlier someone used the expression, the proof's in the pudding. Well, you know, in 2008, we actually signed a coalition deal with the Liberals. The Liberals reneged on it, and that's why Stephen Harper's still in power. So, yes, absolutely, I welcome the opportunity to work with other parties, but more than that, the NDP has a proven track record of being able to work with other parties in order to advance a progressive agenda.
Thanks for the question. Many of us have worked in the private sector, and if our companies behaved as parliamentarians seem to behave, we'd probably be bankrupt. I think it is absolutely fair for us to demand that our politicians work together, and it's one of the reasons I took the Greens, or that I chose to run for the Greens or under their banner, is because it's one of the few promises that I'm willing to make to constituents. I'm going to go to work every day, and I'm going to invite my colleagues in Parliament to work together to solve all our complex issues. And if at the end of the day we don't solve all the problems, I'm going to go back in the next day and I'm going to invite my MP colleagues to work together to solve all our complex issues. The Green Party doesn't have all the answers. The Liberals, the NDP, the Conservatives, the Libertarians, none of us have all the answers. That's not the way life works anymore. We need to get together. We need to demand that MPs work together. We're on the same team, Team Canada.
My leader, Justin Trudeau, has committed recently that he will not support a Stephen Harper government. So that does put some constraints, shall we say, on what I'm able to do with the Conservatives, but I'm fine with that position. I will remind my friends in the audience that Justin Trudeau has consistently supported the inclusion of Elizabeth May in all of the debates, and so we have very good will and a demonstrated ability to work with other parties. As far as our position vis-a-vis the NDP, the position is no formal coalition, but that still leaves a broad variety of other options available on the table. So it is very conceivable that the Liberals, the NDP, and the Greens could work together to get a budget passed through through Parliament. Thank you. Merci beaucoup.
Okay, question number 9. The order for this question is 1, 2, 4, 3. And the question is, Between 1891 and 1910, about 500 students from 40 reserves on the prairies attended the Regina Indian Industrial School.
Go with, we will implement all recommendations from the Truth and Reconciliation Commission to honor the memory of all residential school survivors and the legacy of colonialism. We are in favor of a missing and murdered Indigenous women in inquiry. We also have pledged $2.6 billion over the next 4 years for core First Nations funding. And we are the party of the Kelowna Accord. Back in 2005, it was a monumental achievement when Prime Minister Paul Martin and Ralph Goodale negotiated the Kelowna Accord that had the buy-in from the feds, all provinces, territories, and First Nations leaders, and we need to get back to the Kelowna Accord as soon as humanly possible. That's a good deal.
Okay, so one of the disadvantages of being the last person to answer is that a lot of the good points have already been made. I'm very proud of the role that Jack Layton played in securing a national apology for residential schools. Certainly, the NDP has been at the forefront of advocating for justice for Aboriginal people, and certainly that's something I would continue to do as a candidate. We've been pushing for a national inquiry into missing and murdered Indigenous women. We also want to respond and take action to the recommendations of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. And yes, back to the original question, I do think the federal government has a role to play in preserving and honoring the site at Pinky Road. Thanks very much.
We're at question number 10. The order is 4132. And it states, will your leader be a prime minister for peace? In particular, what is your party's stance on the Israeli-Palestinian conflict? And the order is 4132.
Question. Yes, Justin Trudeau has pledged to end the combat mission in Syria against ISIS and ISIL and redirect our forces into a training mission and redirect a far more effort into the humanitarian effort. Again, as I said, that we want to see a return to peacekeeping as the party that created peacekeeping with Prime Minister Lester Pearson. Again, you can count on Liberals to dramatically increase our peacekeeping efforts. Specifically, with respect to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, Justin Trudeau has consistently at home certainly spoken up for groups that have been the target of Mr. Harper's politics of fear. In this case, it's the Muslim community, and vis-a-vis that specific example, all three parties have actually a fairly similar position. It's just we don't have the ferocious rhetoric that accompanies it from the conservatives. We support a two-state solution and moving forward to try and find ways to increase peace. Thank you.
We've got to find a way to stop bombing each other and stop fighting. One of the ways that we want to do this is to take climate action, because in Syria, for example, the civil war was precipitated by an extended drought, which was extended longer and deeper because of climate change. And so if we address climate change, perhaps we won't get droughts that drive farmers from the land into the cities and into poverty and into restlessness and into civil war and then into ISIS taking advantage of the situation. As far as Israel and Palestine goes, I can offer my personal opinion on it. A two-state solution is a good thing. We need to make room for all of our neighbors, not just some of them. And the hardline stance from Mr. Harper, I don't think serves the peace process well. And so we would like to implement a peace process.
Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. I certainly believe that, sorry, Trish? Okay, excellent. So I believe that Tom Mulcair certainly would be a prime minister for peace. I think the NDP has been the most consistent in opposing some of these misguided military interventions in different parts of the world. Certainly we are calling for an end to this bombing in Iraq and Syria. On the Israel-Palestine question, I guess I would have to quibble a little bit with Louis' characterization that all the parties are the same on this. I think the Conservatives and the Liberals have been pretty one-sided on this. I think the NDP has a much more balanced position in terms of, yes, saying Israel definitely has a right to defend itself and a right to exist, but at the same time that the Palestinians really have a right to peace and security and to their own state as well. So I'm very proud to be an NDP candidate here, and I think it's very important to have a balanced position in advocating two secure, peaceful states in the Middle East.
When you look at the map of Israel or Palestine, it is a very small territory. It is like Regina and surroundings. And the trouble is that two nations, that means the Jewish nation and the Arabic nation that lives there, they claim right to the same territory. And it's, if both nations claim right to the same territory and in an exclusive manner, well, you cannot reconcile this. And it's a pity that many other countries or leaders side with one side or the other, so they fight in perpetuity. Now, there is an example of how it was on different reasons of religion was in India. Well, the Indian in India, they live together, and because of their religion, while they had fighting inside, they couldn't live together, so it results in splitting of the two countries. We can call that India and Pakistan is two-state solution now. I will talk.
Okay, I think people have done well enough that we can squeeze one last question in. That's fine with you. The order will be 2-1-4-3. And the question is, veterans' offices have closed, less people are eligible for EI, and millions have been cut from food safety agencies and border security. Will your party defend and enhance the public service and its employees? Would you like that, a repeat on that? Veterans' offices have been closed, less people are eligible for EI, and millions have been cut from food safety agencies and border security. Will your party defend and enhance the public service and its employees? And we start with candidate two.
I'm sorry, you talk about veterans or about public employees?
The public service and its employees, so yes, public employees.
And your question is?
Will your party defend and enhance the public service and its employees?
So we're talking about the public employees as opposed to employees who work for private enterprises. Whether you work in the private sector or public sector, you should have a proper contract that provides you with services and guarantees when you leave the service or you are providing the service. So I don't think we need a special extra regulation for that.
We've got a lot of restoration work to do. There's been a lot of cuts. The Green Party does support the public service. We need a robust, independent, well-funded, well-running public service. We want to unmuzzle scientists and make it mandatory to publish publicly funded scientific findings, because they're ours. We want to reopen Veterans Affairs offices. We want to restore a lifetime pension to veterans, disability pension, instead of the lump sum payment. We want to ensure that the search and rescues on the coasts, they've been cut as well. We want those back. There's so much in the public service that we need back, and the Greens have committed to repealing a whole raft of laws that have come down that need to be looked at again.
Yes, so in the past 10 years, there's essentially been an assault on our public sector service employees, and then we're going to be hearing lots more about that tomorrow night, by the way, at the Italian Club, so you're all welcome to join us for more in-depth on that one. But that also includes, by the way, our RCMP, and ironically, $600 million have been rolled back under Mr. Harper from the RCMP. That includes our military. $15 billion has been cut or lapsed with the military. It includes our tax collectors, our CRA, a whole host. And yes, we support our public service employees. Justin Trudeau has been highly critical of a number of Mr. Harper's anti-union initiatives. We will stand up for collective bargaining and the union's right. And we made a variety of changes to EI to allow more compassionate caregiving, more flexible conditions. We're pledged to reopen veterans service centers and a $300 million investment for our veterans. So yes, surely we support our public service. Merci beaucoup.
The NDP's position is to reopen the veterans service offices and also to improve veterans benefits. We also want to improve the accessibility, the level and the duration of employment insurance benefits so that people can get that help when they're laid off through no fault of their own. We want to restore funding for things like food safety, border security, the RCMP. But while we're talking about important public services, I want to add one more: door-to-door mail delivery. The NDP is the only thing. The Conservatives are cutting it back. The Liberals are kind of wishy-washy on it. The NDP is the only major party that's clearly committed to keep door-to-door mail delivery. It's important things for seniors. I guess the Green Party is signaling they're also in favor of it, so I'll give them a shout-out too. Important for seniors, important for people with mobility challenges, really important public service for everyone. Thanks so much.
Okay, we will now close the portion of the program of audience questions. I would like to commend you for some great questions. If your questions did not get asked, the candidates will be downstairs, and I'm sure you can phone their offices as well, and they'll be happy to talk further. We'll now go to closing remarks. Again, there will be 3 minutes for each candidate, and we'll be going in reverse order of the opening remarks, so it will be 4, 3, 2, 1. So starting with Louis Brown, I'll invite you forward for the closing remarks.
Well, thanks very much, ladies and gentlemen. This takes us to the concluding part of our evening. I certainly want to thank my fellow candidates who attended this evening. I want to thank all of you and our moderator and our timekeeper. We are pledging the largest infrastructure investment in Canada's history, as I said before. We want to get program delivery happening immediately. Justin Trudeau has been very honest and frank with Canadians about how we're going to do that. We are going to run some small deficits for a couple of years, and then we're going to get back to balance, just like we did in the 1990s, the last time we inherited and fixed a conservative mess. And we will do it again with your support starting in October of this year. Now, because our leader has been frank and honest about that, we are taking it on the chin, and we're prepared to take it on the chin from our right-wing opponents and right-wing pundits. Now, mind you, tonight,
my chin's doing rather well. I didn't have a conservative opponent to throw any curveballs at me. But nonetheless, the most heated Twitter exchange I've been in so far was with the president of the Canadian Taxpayers Federation about that. So we're being honest about it. We're going to make a massive investment in infrastructure, transit, social infrastructure, green infrastructure. As well, we're standing up for the middle class and all those working hard to join it. Our tax cut, as I said earlier, we will cut the taxes of all Canadians who earn between $44,000 to about $215,000. We're going to raise the taxes on the super rich to balance that off. Our Canada Child Benefit will give more money to 9 out of 10 Canadian families than under Mr. Harper's current plan. One of the ways that we're going to do that, we're going to stop sending money to millionaires and redirect it to the families who need it the most. Under our Canada Child Benefit, 315,000 Canadian children will be lifted out of poverty. Additionally, we've committed $150 million new dollars for CBC and Radio Canada. We strongly support. Thank you very much. We strongly support our public broadcaster, as is evidenced by our funding commitment to it. We also want to double the investment for the Canada Council for the Arts to $360 million from the current $180 million allocation. And as one of your former board members at the Mackenzie Art Gallery for 6 years, that's something that I strongly support as well. I was also the City Council. Also the City Council liaison on the committee for the Arts Advisory Committee at City Hall for several years. So when it comes down to standing up for the middle class and all those working hard to join it, you can count on the Liberal Party of Canada to do so. Additionally, it's one of the things that Mr. Harper's moral compass has just really dramatically malfunctioned with respect to our veterans. I don't understand that. As a former reservist myself, I strongly support our veterans. We should be taking care of these very men and women who are prepared to put their life on the line for us. Thank you so very much. Merci beaucoup.
Well, thanks so much. I really appreciate the organizers putting this event together. I really appreciate everyone giving up an evening to come here and check it out. I really appreciate all the excellent questions. We've covered some really good topics tonight, but there's actually one that I was kind of expecting from this crowd that we didn't get to, and that was Bill C-51. I'm really proud to be running for the NDP, which led the opposition to this totally unnecessary and overreaching surveillance law. I kind of wish it had come up because it would have provided a rare and glorious moment of agreement between the NDP and the Libertarians. But in any case, I do really think that that's an important point of distinction between us on the one hand and the Liberals and the Conservatives who voted for that bill on the other hand. But overall, what I found tonight was that there were a lot of agreement on the main issues. There was actually a lot of consensus on this stage. You heard a lot of the candidates, I think, making some pretty similar points. And I think that most Canadians actually do want to achieve a change in government. And the question before us, the question that you'll have to ask yourself in the voting booth in just under 3 weeks from now, is how best to achieve that change. And I suppose I would remind everyone that in the last federal election, the Conservatives won almost every riding in Saskatchewan, and in every single riding that they won, the NDP came second. So if you want to achieve a change of government, if you want to replace Stephen Harper, the only way to do that in our first-past-the-post system is to vote NDP. And I wish I didn't have to make this argument, because we should have a system of proportional representation where people could just vote based on what they believe. The NDP is committed to bring that into place, but we have to fight this election under a first-past-the-post system. And it's a particularly stark choice in Regina Louvain, where all the candidates in this stage are running. Elections Canada reports that if these new boundaries had existed in the last federal election, the vote within them would have been 45% NDP to 44% Conservative, all the way down to 8% Liberal, 3% Green. So I'm in a really tight race against the Conservative candidate who didn't show up tonight, and I would really appreciate your support in defeating him so that we can have a non-Conservative MP on the western part of Regina. Some other evidence that came out, we had this poll on the front page of the Leader Post a few days ago. It suggests that the Conservatives were a little bit ahead of the NDP, But again, it confirmed that what we're dealing with in Regina Louvain, as in most Saskatchewan ridings, is a two-way fight between the NDP and the Conservatives. So I certainly appreciate all the different parties and perspectives, but I would really make the appeal that if you want to change the government, if you want to get Stephen Harper out of there, please vote NDP. Thanks very much.
Which is about warrantless arrest and searches, and also the issue about bulk online surveillance and phone line surveillance. We lost some civic rights on the pretense of protecting our from terrorists and from getting security for our. We have to pay with our rights for security. Now the other thing is we should restore the democracy, which I mean that right now our system evolves into something that is partitocracy. The parties actually rule, not the MPs. The MPs cannot vote their conscience in the parliament. So what I propose that the MPs have autonomy. The way it is, Samara Canada is one organization who proposes reforms to our system that would empower MPs to voice the concerns of their constituents and their conscience. The other point, now the proportional representation may not solve it. Proportional representation would make the district much larger, where the contact between the MP and the electorate will be diminished actually. So I would prefer not going this route. Now, as for the other important thing is our fiscal responsibility. Our country is running more and more into debt. The 8 years the current government never could balance the budget. They promise right now, actually all the parties promise that hopefully this will happen. Otherwise we will go bankrupt. We are paying too much already in servicing the debt, and we are in danger of heading towards austerity, which will not benefit anybody. Part of this trouble of imbalanced budget are bailouts of failing companies or failing industries and corporate welfare. This is immoral that the tax money from middle class is being transferred for those who own the big corporations or big banks. It is simply not fair that it is happening. When we bail out for billions of dollars, then the treasury is empty. And the next step that government does, well, we don't have any money for basic infrastructure, we don't have money for healthcare, for education. This is what the taxes are collected for. They were not collected to give so for some multinationals that basically have bigger power to lobby government for handouts. The bailouts are also bad and it favors obsolete industry. If the horse-drawn carriages want bailouts, they would get the bailouts rather than supporting modern cars or planes and so on. So, my time is up. Thank you.
Thank you for organizing this and for hosting. Thank you for coming out. Thank you, candidate colleagues, for your presentations. I want you to think about some of the greatest leaders in history for a bit. Martin Luther King Jr., Mahatma Gandhi, Nelson Mandela. How many of them stood up before the people and said, be afraid, be very, very afraid. We have largely bought into it, we have been invited as a population into a politics of fear. We gotta stop Harper. Justin's just not ready. The NDP, well, they're gonna tank the economy. And the Greens, well, we love the Greens. We love Elizabeth May. Too bad they just don't have a chance. You know what? That's all bold. Every single one of those, pardon me, that's all bold. The Greens do have a chance. I'm inviting you, Elizabeth May is inviting the Canadian population to a politics of courage, a politics of getting to know our neighbors, of empathy, of action. And of course we can do this. If Regina Louvain or any of the other ridings in Regina, if any riding in Canada wants a Green candidate or a Libertarian candidate, we can put those people in office. Here's the numbers. With what would have been Regina Louvain last election, 23,000 people did not show up. They voted for none of the above. The person who would have won would have needed 15,545 votes. So maybe we should have sent none of the above to Ottawa, because that's apparently what most of our neighbors want. Go and I want to represent my neighbors. And here's the other flaw in our democracy right now, the foundational issue. The NDP, 100% of votes whipped. The Liberals, 90% votes whipped. The Conservatives, 76% votes whipped. So it really doesn't matter what the constituents say, it matters what the party leaders say. The Greens, no votes whipped. I can vote for my constituents. So you want to know how to make this happen? I hear this, when we talk to Liberals and NDPs and Conservatives even at the door, they say, we love Elizabeth May. We like what she has to say. You're our solid second choice. Or if they're Green lovers, it's like, I'm afraid of Harper getting in. You know what, Harper's not the problem, he is the result of the problem. The problem is first past the post, the problem is too much power in the Prime Minister's office, we have to divest it. Here's the short answer on the math. Each one, reach one, five times we win. We can do it, it works.
Thank you. Again, your candidate participants for this evening have been Tamala Friesen for the Green Party, Wojciech Dalata for the Libertarian Party, Aaron Weir for the New Democratic Party, and Louis Brown for the Liberal Party. I would like to thank them all for taking part and for doing so well in adhering to the time constraints. We can tell you've been all had lots of practice. I'm now going to invite Kathy Gibson to close the formal part of the evening with a few words on behalf of the Community Coalition for Planning Committee.
I'm doing it without notes. First of all, I think we should all give a really great hand to Patricia. Moderator I have ever come across. Excellent. And I'd like to add Pat's, Trisha's comments to the candidates. I think you're all awesome. But when working on this program, I really come to appreciate what it might be like to decide that you're going to run for office. I admire that you're putting your hat in the ring, that you're sticking your neck out, and your chin, and any other bodily part. And I know that your friends and family have to sacrifice a lot because there's just so many demands upon you, and I thank you very, very much. In fact, I was thinking, the quality of people we have here, I can't understand why our government is so bad. Church, United Church, because they are so generous with their building, and they made it possible for us to put this on because we were a group, sort of a ragtag group. We have no money, no phone number, no office. We just got together and met. So I invite you to go back downstairs. We have the building for a little bit longer. And talk with people, help us clean up if you feel that way, and you know, just go home and think about all you heard tonight. I know I learned a thing or two. How about the rest of you? When you get downstairs, go talk to Jim. He's the one with the beard. He said something about a website and a posting and what have you. So he'll explain it better than I ever could, because I don't do websites. Again, thank you so much for coming.